We're here to present 399 Sands, a new parking garage and industrial and office space at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, the Admiral Dome area. We presented to the commission before, we received your comments, appreciated the comments, and incorporated the comments in a variety of ways that I'll try to briefly describe to you. So, just a very quick recap. The site is located at the western end of the Navy Yard, close to the intersection of Navy Street and Flushing Avenue. It's part of the Admiral Grill Complex. It actually forms the kind of north end of the Admiral Grill Complex. You see the site here. This is Admiral's Row. Photographs of the site. Existing gatehouses, which we'll see in the rendering and the relationship of the new building to the existing gatehouses on Navy Street. With views within the site, this is the site here, currently a vacant site. And this is an overview using an aerial photograph with the massing of the buildings. So these blocked out buildings are the other Admiral's Row buildings, which the commission has also reviewed. This is the proposed 399 Sands garage and overbuild. And I think this, with one of the changes that made the addition of the green roof at the top of the building, but I think this view shows the scale of the building in relation not only to some of the other large structures in the Navy Yard, but to the scale of some of the surrounding residential buildings that are near to the Navy Yard. And again, just a diagram showing the context, unless the questions I would draw on this. And here's a rendering of the proposed building in the context of the Admiral's Row development, the other Admiral's Row buildings, the central open landscape parking area, the new enclosed parking with four stories of industrial space above and the fifth floor of office space. So again, site plan shows the same thing in plan, the central open parking area, the other Admiral's Row building, and 399 Sands completing the campus that is Admiral's Row. So, the updates from our last review in September, the previous ones on the left, and the current design is on the right. Taking into account the Commission's comments, we've really taken a fundamental re-looking at the design. We previously came to you with a brick facade, more of a historic feeling. So we're have changed that to a precast concrete facade, which reflects the structure of the building, which is a precast concrete structure, and also the honesty of and directness of an industrial building. Made a variety of other changes that I'll explain in detail. In the previous design, the base was a dark tinted concrete. We brought the natural color concrete down to the ground. As you'll see in more detail, we extended some of the windows as well as columns to integrate the garage with the overbuild of the structure above it. We've added the perforated signage panels at the corners of the building to mark entries, and a variety of other changes that we'll get into. So again, on the top is the previous design, and below is the current design. So just very quickly, the change from brick to precast, to natural finished precast, the addition of a perforated metal panel with signage at both the parking entrance at the west end as well as the industrial office building entrance at the east end of the building. We've kept the canopy that we had previously at the entrances to really emphasize the entrances, but eliminated it in between to further promote the growth of planting on the metal screen that will cover the garage area as well. We've also added a board form texture. I think this was a specific comment, and we looked at it and liked the idea to the precast panels at the circulation towers for the at the east end for the overbuild and at the west end for the garage. So while the field of the building is a natural finish concrete, natural precast concrete, these circulation elements that extend out from the building have the board form texture to distinguish them, but being the same family of materials. This is the north facade, which again, the change from the brick to precast, the board form finish, as you see here on the north side of the industrial office building circulation core that extends from the building. And this is the west facade facing Navy Street. And what we've done here is a couple of things. We've again, the signage panel that I mentioned, the perforated metal with the address and identification of Wegmans parking. Since this is the parking entrance, you see a little bit of a board form concrete on this. We brought windows down. This is a stair that serves the industrial and office floors. We've introduced these windows to match the windows at the industrial floors. Again, to integrate the building, we brought columns down and maintained a comparable proportion for the concrete spandrels, again, to integrate the base of the building with the portion above. And finally, on the east facade, this is the portion of the building that faces the Navy Yard. This is the circulation core for the industrial and office floors, and you see here the board form concrete texture, and we've introduced a polycarbonate glazing at the stair. You actually see the shadow of the fire stair, and I think this will be a very nice feature for tenants of the building, and those who don't take the elevator may encourage at least some people to use the stairs, as well as being a visual element on the exterior of the building. And in plan, there are relatively few changes. As I mentioned, we've eliminated the extent of the canopy between the two entrances to promote the growth of our green screen at the garage, south-facing garage facade. Again, no substantial changes to these plans in terms of the functionality of the building. And the major change is at the roof level. We've added a green roof. There is a significant amount of mechanical equipment. It's a little faded out on the screen, but you see the various HVAC units on the building. So what we've proposed to do is to have a green roof system around the perimeter of the roof to green the roof. And this is a detail of the change in configuration for the green screen in front of the parking. We previously had the canopy. We were going to leave a gap in the canopy. And you know, we looked at a number of ideas, but at any rate, we proposed to eliminate the canopy except at the entrances I mentioned, so that leaving a space for the planting at, both in ground and as the plants climb up the mesh to grow and thrive. This was something I think we showed last time, really showing the circulation patterns, and just quickly, very quickly to review this. The green indicates the circulation for automobiles coming into the garage. The garage entrance is here. The exit is coming out this way to Navy Street. Pedestrians who will be primarily coming from Wegmans or the other Admiral's Row buildings will cross at a crosswalk here and either go to the elevators or stair that serve the upper levels of the parking, or if they're on this level, at a handicap space or park somewhere on the ground level, will enter the garage here. And the blue represents a pedestrian path for people coming to the industrial and office space. So their entry is here, served by passenger-free elevators, the stair that has the polycarbonate glazing. We do have loading docks, loading berths, I should say, where trucks can pull up and the loading area opens to the freight elevators. A question that came up in our last presentation, I just want to confirm, due to the zoning requirements, we do have to provide additional loading berth spaces. We are showing these being a grass creek type paving to green the site a bit, and the question came up as to whether that would viable with trucks, and I think the feeling on the Navy Yard's part is that these would be only occasionally used, if at all, if we're really fulfilling a zoning requirement, and these berths, which are fully paved, would be the primary loading berths. And again, the plans, typical parking level plan, typical industrial floor plan, it's a very simple scheme with a central corridor, a main circulation core, and a secondary egress there at the other end. Various services aligned along the core, and the space is demised flexibly for a variety of tenants. And finally, the top floor is an office floor plan, which is shown as an open space now, but maybe supervised by a tenant or tenants. In section, there's really the same section, same height of the building, same configuration, with the four levels of parking, four levels in the darker blue of industrial space, and a single level of office space at the top of the building. And then the proposed, currently proposed south elevation, as I described, with the precast concrete panels, planting at the garage, the large perforated metal panels with signage, the north facade, the west facade facing Navy Street, as we reviewed, and again the east facade, again the board form, textured concrete, polycarbonate glazing on the stair, breaking up the mass of that circulation tower. And some axonometric views focusing on the building from different viewpoints. Again, looking more or less northeast, the parking entry in the distance is the industrial office entry, and then the opposite view, looking southeast, the industrial entry, which ramps up. We are in the flood hazard zone, so ramps up to the entrance level. Northeast, that tall circulation core with the board form texture not shown, the polycarbonate glazing as a column, and then looking northwest, sort of from Navy Street, maybe as we've been walking from the F train at York Street, the automobile entrance, the pedestrian entrance to the parking, the parking ramp, the sign, the perforated metal signage element. Some overviews, again showing the extent of the green roof, and some close-ups of the entrance. This is the pedestrian entrance at the parking portion of the project, the board form concrete. We're proposing a perforated metal panel on a frame so it stands away from the surface of the concrete, we're showing 12 inches, something in that order, so that it has a separate identity, really marking the entrances to the building. And this is at the east end, the loading berths, the pedestrian entrance, stairs and ramp to gain access to this elevated entrance, the canopy at the entrance with the panel above. And some of the materials, the typical precast, board form texture, which will be done with a form liner. This is precast, not cast in place concrete. Polycarbonate glazing, metal panels at the office level, window framing, canopy at the entrances, the mesh for the planting, and the perforated panel material for the signage elements at the entrance. So the landscaping, I think we discussed last time, some on-grade planting to green the site in areas that are not circulation areas, including this grass creek at the supplemental loading booths. And then the primary element being the vine plantings along the wall of the parking area. And of course the green roof that I mentioned, which occupies the perimeter of the main roof of the building. And some of the specific planting materials are shown here. The in-ground planting is located here and here with the hope that, over time the planting will go over. These areas are not planted, as I mentioned earlier. Those are the pedestrian entrances to the ground level of the parking, both directly to the handicapped spaces as well as for people parked elsewhere on the ground floor. Illustrations of some of the plant materials that the landscape architect is proposing. And then finally, some of the lighting that were light fixtures we're proposing for general illumination as well as security. We are proposing on the Wegmans side, on the portion facing Navy Street, because per zoning, we're not allowed to have internally or edge illuminated signage, to have a light fixture that will cast light, indirect light on the sign at night, and to have edge illuminated letters on the south facing sign that faces towards Wegmans itself and towards the on-grade parking area. And finally, a view of the proposed building at the Sand Street entrance of the Navy Yard, looking past the gatehouses to the proposed structure. Thank you.
I think the building is all better. Thank you. Looks great. And I think the, you know, the continuation of the material in the window wall around here is giving more light to the internal spaces is great. And also the polycarbonate to give light for people looking at it is great if they're looking to the east. I guess I just, my main question, I don't know if you had a sample of that screen that's going on the signage.
We don't have a physical sample with us.
Trying to understand the weight of that and the scale of that, and then also the, I don't know, the manual has some comments about the signage in particular.
Okay.
And where and how we are to see it, and who it's for, I guess. You know, because this is the same view we showed us last time at the lodge, but when I look at the earlier photos of the site, you know, because they're the same scale and they're just repeating each other on the corner. So when you come on Navy and you're looking to the north, what do you see? And then when you're going the other way on Navy, and then when you're, you know, driving, like, who is this meant for?
Well,
it seems like it's one scale.
Yeah. Okay.
Duplicating itself. So, and I was just wondering if you had a graphic designer who's putting this together for you on that.
No, we don't.
Okay. One question I had about the signage, real quick. I think the building was great. One question I had about the signage is that, you know, 399 is that the street address? Because I know there's a nomenclature for all the other buildings.
Yeah, this is not the Navy Yard nomenclature. It's actually a small circular sign that's a Navy Yard standard that's applied at the eastern end of the building. Adjacent to that entrance. I think part of the idea of the 399, which is the street address, is a branding of the building.
Number.
Oh, it is a
number. It is a number. It's basically the yard, any new building has a number that just isn't part of the table. So.
Workhouse, yes, it's for.
It serves us.
But, and it's, you know.
It's meant to be the brand new building.
The identity of the building is 399. So the idea, again, you know, your comments you've all taken, was that this is the 399, which repeats here and here, is really kind of a, obviously a very large scale graphic. The idea that you cut into the perforated metal so that it doesn't read as an applied sign, it's part of the plane of the perforated metal. So it has a little bit of, you know, maybe reads more strongly here, but it reads a little more subtly, but it reinforces, you know, a large building in a large scale. We felt it was an appropriate scale to identify the building from whichever angle you're looking at. The Wegmans signage are intended to be applied, cut metal letters that would be over the surface of the perforated metal, so they would be distinct in appearance and character from the 399 letters. Obviously, they're somewhat smaller, and the idea of those signs, which again, as you point out here on both the signs, is primarily for Wegmans customers who are one of the primary users of the garage, who are not like necessarily daily users, as they approach the building to know where the parking entrance is. And again, we looked at a number of options for the height of those. This seemed like an appropriate location at a lower level, aligned with the bottom of the panel. It seemed like the signage would be too obscure. Higher up, it might be too prominent and also compete with the 399. So we located it in this kind of middle range of the panel.
I think the 399 works very well as a brand for the building. Is that way? I guess the two questions I have then are, you know, should it be 399 or should it be part of the overall, you know, nomenclature of the new yard? And I'm not sure which one would be the best. And then, you know, given the context of, you know, what this building.
But she was just saying that it's both.
Yeah, I'm sorry,
for these new buildings, the address is the new yard number, so they're making.
Oh, so 399 is the building number, okay.
Yeah.
For instance, I think originally they were thinking it could be 399 Sands. We said we would prefer to have it say 399 because all of our buildings just have, typically our buildings have numbers, they don't have the words associated with it, so we actually were pushing the neighbor side just to be 399 because that does coincide with how we treat the rest of our buildings, like building 77 and 399. It's the same.
I think that reads really well as an identity for the building. I think the Wegmans parking lot doesn't read so much the sign, but more is also kind of branding too, so it could be a scale relationship or the placements. I don't know if it needs to be directly on that sign, because it feels like there's, you know, two kind of logos on one surface. I don't know if it's possible to have, you know, kind of freestanding level or. But I think the, you know, kind of hierarchy of the two signs together, it feels too similar.
Maybe go back to elevation. We did try to offset them, you know, in terms of alignment, you know, with the 399 being right aligned and the Wegmans sign being left aligned. Again, we wanted it to, the Wegmans parking sign, and you know, your comments are well taken, we wanted it to be large enough so that it would be readily identifiable to people driving, and I think that's the primary audience for the Wegmans sign.
Is it literally no other potential parkers in that garage other than the customers who are?
Oh no, there will be other employees at the.
That's what I thought.
But the thought was those people are coming every day, and they know, you know, maybe the first time there might be a little confusion, but you know, on a daily basis they know where they're going. It's the people going into Wegmans, of course, they'll be return customers, but you know, many will be first. nine drivers, and it's really, that's why the signage is directed at them. I mean, it could just say parking,
yes,
but Wegmans is the primary tenant, and I think we felt that their identity was very important as the primary tenant of Adams Road.
If you look at maybe just typesetting it in the book of New York typeface of Wegmans parking.
We could, although I know Wegmans, you know, from the discussions we had, Wegmans is very, very sensitive about their typeface. You know, the word parking, I think, is a little more neutral, but the word Wegmans is, I'm not sure how they would feel about, you know, changing their particular font.
They do have the opportunities on their own shopping and also have their particular font. There seem to be plenty of opportunities for them to show their brand.
Yes, and again, I don't have to be argumentative.
No, no.
The, a big rationale for this project was the requirement that Wegmans had as a precondition of leasing the space that they are leasing was to have this parking. And in Wegmans' eyes, this is a, really an important and integral part of their operation.
Well, maybe there can be a little bit of more work on the mesh sign.
Yeah, we can.
I think the letters look great, and
yeah, we can.
It just seems there's been so much success on this building, and I'm really happy with the direction it's taken. And grateful to you and the Navy Yard for supporting all those changes, which we know were not necessarily easy or fun to make. So we want this to be perfect. Not that we necessarily are the arbiters of perfect, but there was a fairly broad sense that of all the changes, like all of them were good, but the sign was slightly problematic. So maybe the answer is take all the positives and work a little longer on the sign. And the sign, I guess everyone feels the $399 is good. It's just maybe the placement of the Wegman. I don't know. Let's do a little work on that, and then we're good to go.
Well, yeah, we really appreciate the positive feedback. We have worked hard at this, and we appreciate the input we've gotten from the commission. It's, I think, really helped with design. And yes, we're happy to look at fine-tuning the sign.
I think actually, based on what you described, the rendering is also a bit misleading, because if you embed the $399 in the operation and the other, with the parking is proud of the perf, it's going to, they're not going to read quite, I mean, I guess it shows here a bit because it's $399 is grayed out,
right,
and the Wegmans is, so this one probably shows it as clearly.
Well, I think specifically you show it as a, you're showing it different than what you just described. You said it's a cutout, but the example shows some kind of white letter behind, so it's not clear.
Well, it's too different on the different
right
side.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, well, we'll try to come back to it with a little more detail on the sign.
And if the graphic designer could design it.
Okay.
You know, in terms of its proportion to the street and the pedestrian network, because that's a really handsome.
Yeah, Billy's a really nice guy. For the Navy Yard, more than we're going to see the, there's a whole new security gate, right? That's
there will be, yes.
And you'll definitely show that to us?
Yes, yes. We actually, that's a project we'll be working on in the coming year. We're actually going to be doing all of our gates. So we will certainly, this is going to be a big project that we'll want to, it'll be come up.
I know there's changes to the Sand Street historic gate, but then there's a whole new
There's
gate.
A whole internal, so we'll,
internal
it will be combined, it'll be a,
right.
It'll be gate and wayfinding together combined, so we will certainly bring that to you.
Great, we'll be interested in seeing.
Yeah.
I just want to say thank you for the, all of the landscape changes.
Yeah, they're good.
Really
they're
excellent.
Good.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Good morning, commissioners. Nick Hutnage from DOT. We're here today with folks from New York City Center, as well as the DLR Group, designing the project. I'm going to introduce Mark Lippman, who's going to explain explain the genesis of the project, and then Tom Gallagher is going to go through the design.
Good morning. I'm Mark Bitford, the Senior Vice President and Managing Director of City Center. This project was conceived of quite some time ago as a part of planning for 75th anniversary season at City Center, which will start in September of 2018. At 75 years old, we want to honor the history and the past of City Center, and also get more people to know what City Center is and start coming to City Center in the future. We're planning a lot of special programming, both on our state and around the city, working in partnership with the Museum of the City of New York and the New York Public Library for display of archival material and a lot of special performances. So I'll be happy to answer questions when this is over, but I'm going to hand it over to our partner.
All right, good morning. My name is Tom Gallagher. As Nick said, I work for DLR Group, which is a firm that specializes in design and performing arts. I'm in the New York office and happy to make this presentation for you. So, City Center, I think, as everyone knows, is on 55th Street between 6th and 7th Avenue on the north side. This is the location slide for the project. These are reference images looking northeast, at our building, just for context. This is looking at the face of the building. It's a neo-Moorish piece of architecture, 1923, with typical Arabesque Moorish design attributes. You can see here the existing sidewalk, which is alternating bands of dark concrete, which match the DOT-approved dark gray and light concrete, and then an existing wheelchair or handicap ramp. This is looking towards the northwest, looking along the street. So this is in your packet. I'm not going to read all of this, but just as Mark mentioned, 1923 the building was built. 1943, Mayor LaGuardia made it the home of the City Center. And 1976, it was committed to being preserved by the dance theater. It's on the historic register, state and federal levels. And regarding this existing sidewalk, that it was initially implemented in 1997, and then due to some water infiltration, was redone in 2005 to match what was done previously. This is our site plan, and you can see, zoom in a little. The alternating bands that align with the five doors in the center. This is our wheelchair access ramp on the west side. And this is the layout, and I'll talk a little bit more about the design of the individual plaques. This is the layout of the plaques. This is the wheelchair ramp, which matches the existing footprint, but made in more enduring materials that work and are referenced the existing materials of the building. The ramp has a granite curb now that matches the stone curb at the base of the building, and then brass rails burnished to match the handrails of the existing hardware on the doors. The design of the design of the medallions is meant to reference the patterns and the language of the design of the Moorish architecture on the facade and on the other side of the building. That's an existing image. And that's the proposed view. And we have examples of the medallion, the plaques here on the table. For reference, for precedence, we've studied the light plaques at the Apollo Theater and also at Madison Square Garden. In fact, 212, our graphic design consultant, had done the Apollo Theater plaques. This is a little more detail on the design references, which are, you know, Moorish architecture, as I think you probably know, is inspired by platonic geometric forms that are laid
laid out in a way that reaches towards the infinity, and that's a general description. There's a lot of different applications, but we're trying to apply that language in not just the shape of the medallion, but facts, but also how they're laid out on the sidewalk. So these are the actual plaque designs. We have the name plaques with about 1 inch tall letters, extending about 1'2", which are the same size as the letters in the Apollo Theater, made to be very legible at standing height. And then we have a blank plaque, which is a key element. We have about 33 of these initially. We also have a Founders Panel plaque, Walk of Fame intro plaque, to introduce the project and provide context for those Walk of Fame. So reference images of the materials I described, the handrail, burnished bronze, the bronze plaques, the dark gray tinted concrete DOT approved, and the light gray stone curb. This is the slide that outlines the nomination process for names that would actually be recognized in the plaques. City Center has set up a specific nomination selection committee, and they would meet to review candidates that meet at least three of these different criteria: establishing an enduring relationship with the City Center, making a significant contribution to their art form and accomplished at least one of the following at City Center, which includes premier new work, made a career defining stage debut, or appeared in three or more City Center productions, and then contributed to the legacy of New York City Center and its impact on the cultural life of the city of New York, including the founders of the Warrior. And then four is exhibited sustained excellence in their career. So our view is that this is very much a recognition of those artists that have contributed significantly to public cultural in New York City. Actually, I failed to mention. Every other year, that same committee would be reviewing candidates that might be added. And like I mentioned, there's 33 blank plaques. And then, particularly in today's climate, there's a part of the process is recognizing, reviewing names that may be causing concern for something that may have been discovered in the past. That same committee would make that review. And plaques are intentionally designed that they can be reviewed. The introduction plaque here on the west side, the founder plaque here on the east side, the performer name plaques, there's 15 proposed initially, which are the dark ones, and then the blank plaques, 33 are the light. And those have a pattern on them as well. These are just details, and it's this concept review, but we've gone ahead and figured out how we would make these removable and how they would actually be concrete. So there's a removable plate. The plaque on the top is screwed to a plate that has that is secured into the concrete of the spindle, the treadle spindle. And that's really just shown to make sure everyone's aware that they can be removed. These are just other details on how they would be constructed. I don't want to go before everyone with all the details, but that gives you the hopefully the gist of what we're proposing here, at least to answer questions.
So I think 212 also did the Madison Square Garden.
That's right. Is that the other one?
Who is the primary audience for these plaques? But so it'll be the names will be oriented toward the curb?
Correct. And then one of the other ideas with the diamond shape is it kind of emphasizes the flow of the traffic along in the east-west direction. It allows that. But to orient them so they're facing people approaching from the east would be strange for people approaching from the west and vice versa from the west. So really the best strategy is, as has been done before, is you stand in front of the building, you're looking at the building and looking down
Yeah, the only reason I think about it is that before or after a performance, there are usually so many people that you can't read them.
That's a very good point.
So it's, I would imagine it's not really for the theater going public.
Exactly right.
But somebody who might just be walking by and wondering what this building is.
That's exactly right. And that's the better way to address your question, initial question. It's for people that are, it's pre-show and not right around the immediate performance. It's almost like a sign or show poster, one of the many things that you often see in front of the theater that are reinforcing the activities inside. But here it's a heritage.
So as I understand it, you just said that you're interested in the pedestrians walking from east and from west. But am I correct in the way you showed the plaques? The names are oriented from north to south on the sidewalk, so that pedestrians walking, I mean, if I was walking along here, and I would be able to see the plaques if I'm, the names, if I'm walking and they were oriented this way, you see, but instead, it looks as if you're orienting the names to the patrons who collect themselves before going into the theater. You see, I'm going there Thursday night. I'm going to the Encores, so I'll be delighted, and I know City Center well. So I'm a little confused as to, you know, how you're setting these. Secondly, we're very respectful about selection of names and content, but the political people, the Warren, Nicole Mars, others, they have been named and honored and they are known for many different contributions and have been named in many ways because of their long careers in New York and their many contributions. And there seem to be a lot of different criteria of who would go there. Someone did a premiere or something. I'm not sure. I'm just a little confused. Again, I say it respectfully,
sure,
about content, but there seems to be the potential for a lot of names and a lot of plaques, and yet this is the public sidewalk, which does have some criteria for pedestrian circulation and amenities as compared to the particulars of what is going on inside your great building. I can certainly think about ways in which these people could be named in the building as well, and just in questioning how this works on the sidewalk for the various reasons that I just described.
Sure.
I mean, I'll take a step back. You know, the Public Design Commission and all of its long-term history has taken a very protective view to the public spaces of New York City, of which the sidewalk is the most significant, right? We are a walking sidewalk-based city, and it's what distinguishes us from Los Angeles with its Walk of Fame and other places. You have one of the great cultural and architectural monuments in New York City, which is really tight to the street. It's an extremely narrow sidewalk. I've been there many, many times. You have a very ornate, as you described, sort of interior structure, which is beautiful, but not quiet. And therefore, at least from my perspective, to introduce something that it, as it's at its best, is busy, inconsistent with the sidewalks, which we protect through our aggressive stand on newsstands and distinctive sidewalks and all the others, and introduce something that I think is as out, difficult to read, and unlikely to be even visible at all during performance times. I guess at the end of the day, I don't know whether the trade-off justifies a change in a New York City sidewalk. It just doesn't, I don't kind of get it, to be honest. I'm all in favor of honoring people, although as we know, honoring people is controversial. Now we're doing plaques that can be removed. Why do plaques that can be removed, and why not just not do plaques? I mean, why are we taking a sidewalk and making it something that belongs more to city center than to the people of New York? For aesthetic reasons, it doesn't work for me, just to be totally honest. The whole concept doesn't work for me. I love the fact that you're improving the handicap ramp. You should do that. That's great. I wouldn't ask to change the distinctive sidewalks, although I might not have been thrilled with the distinctive sidewalk. But I think that's something that makes it distinctive. To add however many, 35 bronze plaques, 18 of which are blank, I don't know.
More like 50 with 33 blanks.
50 with 33. To me,
there's 33 with 15. How many blanks do you have?
33.
33 blanks. 15.
It's just like, it's just visually, and that's what our aesthetics is what we're about. It's a lot of visual clutter in front of one of the most beautiful buildings in New York City. I think it's nicely done given the assignment, but I don't think, I don't get it.
I would also add that I'm not crazy about the idea of it, and also just to go into a bit more detail, the patterning seems overly busy. Just maybe to take a pattern that's inside a building and bring it up and put it on the sidewalk, which again kind of taking that building and echoing it onto public space that is for everybody. And it's facing somebody getting out of a cab or a car. I'm just the hierarchy of it is I'm missing it. So I would err on the side of putting it in the building.
Yes.
That would be my preference. I understand there is a precedent, which is maybe unfortunate.
There are many things about Madison Square Garden I wouldn't replicate in New York City today. Let me make myself perfectly clear. From the building to the attic to everything about it. So using Madison Square Garden for me, not a compelling argument. So
including that it's going to be tomorrow.
It's inside.
Yeah, so I'll just throw out there from DOT's perspective, because we have, I think, very similar notions about pedestrian circulation and wanting to be very critical of distinctive sidewalk proposals. We lean much more heavily on the call of bigger example as the precedent. That's sort of why we even allowed them to advance this far in terms of concept, just to put that out there. And the thinking was that, again, most places don't deserve this kind of recognition. The city center was a pretty unique one just in its cultural heritage and its contributions to the city. The fact that it is tied to the Department of Cultural Affairs, it's one of the organizations that we have a relationship with.
Cultural institutions here.
Thank you. So it hit a number of things that made it worth, I think, bringing here for this discussion. Again, I'm not qualifying the aesthetic piece, I just wanted to sort of put out the thinking as to why this one seemed to make a little bit more sense than some other similar proposals we've seen for longer frames. And there was, some merit to the potentially to the idea. Obviously, that's a question to still be done.
A question for the city center people. Why would you not put it inside the building? What is the advantage of putting it on a public sidewalk?
One of the challenges we've had, which we tried to address in our 2011 renovation, is even though people remember their high school graduations that certainly before the renovation, no one could find us. We're mid-block. We have no, you can't really see us from 6th or 7th Avenue. And so it was always a challenge. People would always find us when they realized they were gone too far and would come back. So we, in the renovation, we had the marquee and the blade signs, and we found those were helpful. But still, once you're actually on 55th Street, again, you kind of lose track of where you are. And I think part of the reason we thought this would be would add to City Center's overall profile is people might slow down a little and then realize, oh, this isn't a museum, this is a theater. And then they would realize, oh, this is a theater that Leonard Bernstein got his start in, or Casino Domingo thinks of as his first home in New York, and generate more interest in people coming to see what is at City Center in the diverse program that we provide. So that was the thing. The inside of the theater was completely renovated without plan for this kind of a thing. So we would have to go back to the drawing board to figure out where it might even go.
May I just respectfully say that the first point about perhaps the difficulty of pedestrians and others seeing where City Center is, yes. I respectfully say that you have made improvements,
yes,
in the last years that have enhanced the visibility of the theater if you're coming from 7th Avenue or 6th Avenue the outside. So I think that physically, you have very much enhanced the presence and the sight lines of the of an important building for people going there and seeing it. And so that's okay. Secondly, I again respectfully would suggest that if you want to do some of this, to look at the interiors with a new eye. The interiors, great. You have lots of displays. How the displays have occurred has been a little improvised, and you might consider this kind of thing inside, which would really relate to what happened in the building. And sometimes it's a one-time performance, or for others who've been, who are known all over the city for being in other buildings. So it seems very busy and not necessarily the best. And almost detrimental to the sidewalk in a way that shouldn't be.
I guess I just want to clarify one point on the selection process. The idea that it's going to be very difficult to get on one of these plaques is similar to the Apollo Theater, where it's a very strict set of criteria. Again, the selection process, this is a conceptual, so they're also willing to obviously refine that if this is something that we want to move forward. But I think the idea was it would be very much like the Apollo Theater, where it's really only people who are icons and leaders and have contributed quite significantly. So I don't want the notion to be that it's just like anybody who's done a performance at City Center is going to end up there. It's supposed to be very difficult.
Well, I'm not in any way telling them what to do.
Yeah.
They also referenced somebody said, and we would be ready in this climate to even remove people. I mean, this is the kind of thing that I think none of us, I mean, there need to be other criteria, and that opened it up for me. What are we talking about here? And I say that respectfully, that it's your criteria, but that's very confusing.
And also, again, just from knowing the Apollo, the street is much wider.
Exactly.
The street is wider. The sidewalks.
Everything.
I mean, it lends itself to people to just.
Yeah. And it's also only under the marquee.
Yes.
And the public and the main passageway of the sidewalk are unencumbered.
Right.
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 Very good.
Just in terms of traffic, too, is, I mean, people around that area will tend to stop and sort of like,
yeah,
then people are super congested and,
yeah,
with, you know, tourists. I would just say if there's a way to maybe do a similar, you know, geometric plaque, maybe with the same sort of material but on the inside of the building, that would, I think, would function the same way. And then you could sort of add to it in sort of, and spread it open bigger and bigger in some way, so it could be added to. I'm not sure if there's a possibility of shifting heads. You know, because the forms can sort of do the dial thing and keep growing.
Right. Trying to think, that's something to look at. I guess one question I would have is whether PBC would be willing to consider if this were less busy and more rectilinear and simple in its shape and fewer, or whether it's just the existence of plaques on the sidewalk that seems.
I mean, I think that the plaques on the sidewalk, it's just a little distracting, and it almost, for that specific, for what you're asking us to consider, it just doesn't make sense for the public sidewalk. I think that because you're referring to a specific achievements, and you're trying to, you know, make it signature to the design of the building, I think it would just make more visual sense inside the building than outside. So it's not that we don't appreciate you wanting to recognize certain people. It doesn't make sense for the public space.
Well said, Mary. Thank you.
Yeah,
so I think that actually that pretty much summarizes the feeling of the commission. So I'm not sure simple would go very far. But thank you.
Thank you.
Is this how the new medallions would look?
On the right.
On the right?
Yeah.
No way.
That's new.
Yeah.
That's, I think, somehow your presentation that we got didn't show that.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know. Maybe I missed this.
I mean, okay. Well, we'll go through. Great. Perfect. It's good. There's a number of reasons why I was like that.
Yeah.
We're here to talk about the endowments that are on the actual records. I'll run through this pretty quickly, but just up front, the goal is to name 35, so one per country, along 6th Avenue between 42nd and 59th Streets. And this is really a project that, you know, is trying to celebrate the international community and bring what was a really cool piece of history along 6th Avenue into the present day and into a place where it can be maintained and actually preserved for the long term, as opposed to sort of the, you know, haphazard removal that has happened so far. So just a bit of history: 1945, 6th Avenue was renamed Avenue of the Americas. 1960, 220 medallions were installed along the corridor. In the 80s, the city tried to refurbish, did refurbish a number of them. And then in the 90s and ensuing decades, many of them were removed just because they deteriorated. The original medallions were made out of a porcelain enamel. The brackets themselves were also custom made and installed at the time, and not something that DOT or other city agencies had the ability to remake and reinstall. So basically, as they became a safety hazard, they were just taken down. We actually have almost all of them at our shop at Mass Pack, the original ones, along with the brackets. So they haven't been lost necessarily, but it's very difficult to refurbish and keep them on. So again, the new project is going to install new medallions. These will be made out of aluminum, so similar to our street signs, and a vinyl that's custom printed at our sign shop. 35, again, one for each country, and they'll be installed all on mid-block street light poles. So here's a quick overview again just of the corridor. There was a lot of thinking that went into sort of why this place, why this section of 6th Avenue, just sort of boundary-wise, it goes from Bryant Park to Central Park, sort of at the start of the United Nations, down 42nd Street. It's part of 6th Avenue that sort of is very recognizable as 6th Avenue. It's got small towns, all the high-rises. There are also no distinctive lights in this stretch, so it's there are issues just in terms of rack design and installing suspicious work, for example. So there were a lot of factors that worked into sort of why we wanted to choose these. Just to orient everybody, it's sort of the corridor that we're talking about. So, you know, people are very familiar. And then here's an example of one of the plaques at 57th Street, or sorry, one of the medallions. Here's one of the ones that we had removed in the shop. Again, you can see it's sort of a very difficult bracket design for us. And there's a couple
that are also still in place further south as you go along 6th Avenue. The plan is over time to remove sort of all of the ones along 6th Avenue and focus just on these 35. It's a smaller area, easier to maintain, and then we also don't have to deal with, you know, some countries have two, some have one. We don't want to start any international incidents.
People, oh good.
You will.
That's probably true, but more defensible stance. So here's the sort of one-for-one polls. The poll layout along 6th Avenue is pretty consistent. There are a couple that have one, a couple that have two, but we did our best to try to have sort of a consistent mid block. You know, sort of know where to expect to see them as you move around the corridor. Again, so the signs themselves, we verified or are verifying all of the coat of arms with the Mayor's Office of International Affairs. I think we've got most of them verified. There's going to be a handful that we're just double checking. We actually submitted all of the photo arms that we have, so you guys have that on file. The bracket design itself, the goal was to really try to keep it minimalist. It's something that we can fabricate and then in-house at DOT. It's been tested for the wind and the load analysis, so that's why you have the various tabs that hold the medallion on. This also allows us to mount the medallions onto the pole as opposed to onto or suspended from the arm. Which just gives us a lot more short visibility, easier for us to access, easier for us to get up there and maintain. And again, the coat of arms themselves, it's aluminum and vinyl, so the materials that we have and that we know. So we feel very confident that these things can actually be taken care of, that they can be maintained, and that we won't have the same issues that we've had with the porcelain enamel ones, where we just have to take them down and we can't really put new ones back up. So this is the prototype that we had fabricated in the shop. We just made one of these again to do the testing to get it out there. That picture that you saw, this is the tab design, this is the welding, this is the construction document. The picture at the front of the presentation was actually in a light pull out of the means by the design shop that we put up there just to get a sense of what it looked like in scale. So that's the presentation. Happy to answer any questions. Sounds like talking about
the bracket. Okay, how did we go from 220? To whatever now?
35.
Did we lose countries or there were
two? Multiple. So there was multiple medallions, other countries to start with. And then actually countries have been added over time. It was, there's a couple of the islands that many countries in these 3 years. So the final total was 35.
So we have every single country that at a minimum is represented in the United Nations of the Americas, included in the 35.
Correct.
So my problem with this is that Lower 6th Avenue has all the statues of the Americas heroes, like Duarte and Artigas and all that. So why not there? Why not up to 42nd Street?
Sure. I mean, I don't know if you want to. There's been sort of a lot of discussion with the Mayor's Office of International Affairs. I think we want to be able to get this right to start. So we did want to start with a smaller number of plaques that are sort of easier to handle. And then the thing, there's the distinctive light bulb issue. Down 6th Avenue, or Bishop's Grove, and then poles, and other lights that we would just have trouble attaching to. And we wanted to really pick a set of boundaries that sort of felt right. As you go further down 6th, it's just harder to judge. And then the other piece is because there are the statues down on 6th Avenue, and there is sort of already that representation of the Americas, that doesn't really happen as much here in the northern section, even though the entire, obviously, 6th Avenue is called Avenue of the Americas. So I think that's one of the other reasons we were drawn more to.
Well, here's another reason. I mean, yes, I grew up with these signs. I can never read them. The amount of detail in those insignias is very detailed.
Yes.
And they're illegible. You can barely even read the name of the country. And that's with my young mind. So I don't think the plaque design is very good, number one. The other is the whole section of Rockefeller Center has branded banners. Mm-hmm. And I just find the relationship of a branded banner, or in any banner, with these illegible medallions, really complete visual clutter.
I hear you, and I think the banners are something. Hi, I'm Madeline, the director of special projects for our COO's office at DOT. Thanks for having us. I think the banner question is certainly one that would kind of impact the entire quarter, because we do see banners up and down all along. You know, the banners appear both over the sidewalk and over the street at times. So in these cases, technically it would be an easy fix. The riggers can just swing the banners over the sidewalk. You know, as for an association, you know, I hear you, but you know, that's something that is not specific to this portion of the quarter. It's really something all along the Avenue of the Americas.
But it's specifically, I mean, there's so many blocks of Rockefeller Center.
Yes.
And there's like five blocks that are branded Rockefeller Center. I don't know, I get back to the illegibility of them.
Yeah, and I think
there's great detail in them. You know, and you just lose it totally as a pedestrian.
Right.
And I think one thing we've been trying to balance is, you know, things that are too low on poles have a tendency to get hit by things like trucks. So we had to keep them up high enough that there wouldn't be any potential conflicts. And also in terms of the size, these are a 3-foot diameter, which is the same as the previous diameters. And I think we also just need to make sure that things weren't coming out into the street too far and could be pivoted for the Thanksgiving parade. So I think, you know, perhaps we can think about if there's ways we can, you know, visually make it clear. But, you know, the designs themselves have been approved for the consulates.
Sure. And,
right, so I don't know, maybe you can think of a way with the color of the name of the country, perhaps we can explore something there. But I think it is kind of hard because we can't have the pedestrian height because they'll clutter things more, and I think they'll just get hit by things.
And one of the, Anthony Galvin, the director of traffic control and engineering, one of the reasons why we're mounting them so high is so that they don't compete with our important traffic signs.
Yeah.
We don't want to draw attention to those, to these plaques, and not attention to our traffic signs.
I'm just saying, from my mind, this is visual clutter. I bet that's how I feel. But I don't know
what it is. So, I have a question. Obviously, we can, DOT controls the banner program as well, right?
Can you not banner those 22 that are thirsty?
That's something we have to talk about. I don't know, because Rockefeller, it is associated with Rockefeller. I don't know if we have the ability to absolutely say no to those banners, but we can check.
We can talk about it. I think we might have some unhappy stakeholders.
Yeah.
We can check that.
Which is why I think you should do it to the set. But you've got different kinds of poles. I'm not... Ever since I was a small kid, I used to look up at those and think, I don't know.
So, I mean, I think we can look at the height, sort of what...
No, I mean, all what you're saying, I think you engineered it properly, and I understand the height, but at the end of the day, there is so much crap on these light poles, including banners and your very important traffic signs, that I just don't see that this is a improvement to the public right of way. I really don't. And I appreciate you've got a name, Avenue of the Americas, which nobody uses, which very few people use. But I just don't know that this is the right way to honor it.
Is it, I guess just to again try to pull out, is it this particular part of the Avenue of the Americas? Do you think it would be something that is more successful further south?
I mean, other people should speak. I'm going to voice.
Yeah, no,
I'm curious. As someone who was railing against visual clutter just a few minutes ago, maybe it's just for the vague childhood memory. I mean, to me, I would put the medallions, I would either put the medallions up or change the name back to Sixth Avenue. I mean, that's the only choice, because to have it out in the Americas and no references at all to the Americas seems, I mean, it's even insane to me when they changed it, but at least with the medallions, you sort of got it, kind of. And now, without the medallions, I don't know, I don't get it. I didn't even know there were statues down below. I'm going to go look at those again. So, you know, I think you did thank God they're on 202, right? I mean, that's what you started with.
220.
220. So, I don't know. I mean, I think they're, honestly, I think they're fine. I would go for it.
I'm curious, how will you get the artwork for all of the medallions?
So, right? Yeah, they're country's coat of arms. I mean, we're on Citizen Affairs Office of International Affairs to verify that each consulate, this is accurate, up to date, and consistent with the current coat of arms.
And then, what's the framing, like, I guess, like, country naming for each one?
Yeah, could you show us the actual...
So each one has this like typographic treatment on the bottom for each sign or for each
country. Like that font is all the same for all the countries.
So right now, as far as I know, it's based on each individual coat of arms. Are we doing the actual country? Because some coat of arms have a country name, some do not.
Yeah, have a consistent
And I think that font, if there were fonts that were more credible, that's certainly something we could There was something that was clear to the eye.
I think what we have described here are at least two things. One is the prime point of being DOT. You want to be able to have safety and not clutter or confusion of signs. The major signs which parenthetically could be improved of DOT, of directions and safety, something that I think needs a lot of attention. That's the goal. These signs in the past have not been clear for all the reasons that the other commissioners stated. It's well overdue to officially change the name of the Avenue of the Americas to 6th Avenue over 50 years or whatever, it's not been used. And so, but if it was the Avenue of the Americas, it was about the Americas. It wasn't necessarily every country that there is around on in the UN. If you put them up higher for safety, you can't read them. It's very hard to read them anyway. It's not something at all that is needed. And should be relinquished, and other there should be other kinds of examination of how Sixth Avenue works in terms of signs in a major way. I would simply relinquish this and not tinker with it. Don't do it.
Other,
I think I would probably go back to what I was hearing from Phil that I grew up. And this was sort of a big deal. It was renamed Avenue of the Americas.
But it was the Americas.
Well, I will say it's only the American countries that are going to have their names up there. It's not every country in the U.S. It's just the 35 American.
The Americas.
The Americas, right. So north and south.
Yeah. This hemisphere.
Maybe they can't be read, but it does. It's
a smaller
thing. Yes, I mean, you see a sign, you see something that looks like a flag, and you know, I think you intuit, maybe if you're old, you intuit what it is. Some one of these random countries.
It's important to read the country name,
though. I was just an outlier, somebody who didn't grow up here. I had no idea these were ever here.
Really?
Yes, and I do a lot of walking, so I'm. So I'm taking the word for it. I just think if you're going to do something, you're going to do it well.
Yeah.
And it's just that small. And so I think just because there was something that was kind of the size that was there before doesn't mean we should put it back the same way. Maybe it's a great idea.
That's
but I think it needs to be studied.
Yes.
And I think the typeface, we should be able to see it. And then you have this problem with the colors because, you know, the color palette, because each, obviously, you have to be replicating those. You know, coat of arms, they're different. They're supposed to be scalable.
Right.
Sometimes they're just in brass and they're just a relief. So, you know, you should want all the color. I mean, it just seems like somebody really needs a project that could be should be studied more if you're going to do it. That would be my
maybe with the
focus how it's seen and,
right.
Yeah.
And the size of the country's identification.
Right.
So it's visible and the type. So it's visible from the street, and then I totally agree. The coat of arms is totally scalable, and if you have it, you can. They're made to be adjusted, right? Sometimes they go on a PC station. Or your money. Right. So I think it would be good to do exactly that. Let's look at the. graphic so that it's readable and better integrated into the life of the busy street.
And I want to see banner poles. I want to see banners and street signs on it as well.
Yes.
What it looks like.
Really kind of bolsters the economic support that our partners need. But outside of the kind of the nuts and bolts of maintenance and revenue generation, kiosks in plazas can also provide a very, very important programmatic function as well. They provide additional surveillance, additional eyes on the street, and help foster that sense of ownership that we're looking for when we're developing these public spaces. So not only are they providing a very functional role in generating revenue for maintenance, but they're also providing a programmatic function as well, which is very important from an activation perspective. So these are just a couple of examples of how we have been managing this process up until this point. So this particular project is one you may recognize from a few years ago, at Corona Plaza out in Queens. And so this is very typical to all the material that we have been presenting previously. So we would suggest the location of a potential permanent kiosk within the overall design, and in this case, show it in the rendering as well, which was then approved through your typical process with the understanding that we will be coming back to you today. Here's another example. This is Roberto Clemente Plaza in the Bronx. The kiosk location, or the approved kiosk location, is down here in this particular instance. But the process we anticipate is exactly the same. This is Forsyth Plaza in Manhattan, just another example. In this particular instance, the approved kiosk location is right here. And again, it was shown in the rendering that we presented to you at that time. This one dates back to 2013. So just a couple of slides on the design concept before I hand it over to Simon. So when we were commissioning Billings Jackson to undertake this piece of work, we developed a scope for them to follow, which kind of lays out the key criteria, the key objectives that we're looking to accomplish as part of this work. And so we've put a few of the main headlines on this slide for you to keep in mind as we go through the presentation, and then we included a much more detailed description in the narrative that we submitted with our application materials. So first of all, on the dimension, as I mentioned, we were working to a 9x12 footprint and then also a 10-foot height. The interior of the structure should be completely unfinished, and that's to allow for our partners and their sub-concessionaires to fit out upon installation, and it allows for variety or allows for flexibility in the eventual use. This is a permanent structure, but the actual agreement that our partners enter into with their sub-concessionaires may only be for a limited period of time, perhaps just 5 years. So we want to be able to ensure that there's flexibility within the structure to accommodate for different uses. For example, one sub-concessionaire might be running a food service operation, and then it might switch to a florist. So we want to make sure that there's flexibility in the structure. The structure itself should be ADA accessible, both from an operational perspective, but then also from a customer perspective as well. The structure should be compliant with all applicable DOB and Department of Health standards. The design itself should be fitted, or should be assumed to be fitted, with all standard fixtures and fittings. So no need for no customization when it comes to actually fitting these out. We want to be able to keep the process as simple as we possibly can. The structure itself should be largely prefabricated. So as we go through the design, we should be thinking about what we need to do, or what we anticipate doing off-site and then on-site when it comes to the actual delivery of the finished article. And then from a price perspective, we're working to a fee of no greater than $50,000 per unit. So we developed just a few, this is the point I hand over to Simon, but we developed the process really starting at the beginning, looking at the plan view, and then working our way through the levels of detail based on some sort of those key criteria that I mentioned. So with that, I'll hand it over to Simon.
Can I just ask you a quick question? What is the utility
for
this? Is it designed
for DC? So we are, with all of our capital projects that we develop with DDC, we assume a suite of utilities that we've provided to these kiosks. So that includes power, water, sewer, gas, telephone, and data. So for projects, we can go into the process in a little while, but the intention is that all of that utility will be there, developed as part of the capital project, and then the kiosk will be kind of installed on top of that.
Okay.
Great. Thanks.
So as David said, we were sort of given a volume, a 9x12x10 cube effectively to work with. Based on our experience in working in this typology elsewhere. One thing we were primarily interested was getting the, is moving the structure away from the corners, because we were going to need structure in the center anyway. And part of that move was to frame out the doors. So we knew we needed to have a door on one side, and so if we moved the structure inboard, we wouldn't need redundant structure then to frame out the glass. Because one of the primary functions here was to not have a sided cube, so not to have a back. So we wanted to make all sides sort of symmetrical, so bilaterally symmetrical. And then working to the interior of having sort of an ADA turning radius for a wheelchair, you start working from the inside and the outside, and this is the resulting space on the top. What we have is, this is sort of reflected ceiling plan, we have a center space, which will be used for a ventilation hood, but you create light that goes over a surface area here, and then you can have an interior space, interior light here as well. And the rendering, some of the other drawings will sort of show this in more detail. Starting with the cube as a basis, what we wanted to do was figure out a way to break it up and to create transparency. So basically looked at it, almost dividing it equally, creating a glazed zone in the center that would wrap all four sides, and then having what we know we'd have a security enclosure, and thinking that that security enclosure could then double as an awning or protection over the service zone. For the sort of the transactional space, and then at night those shutters would close. And as David was saying, part of the initial thinking of this was that these kiosks would make the plaza in which they were placed inhabitable or usable over 24-hour cycles. So these would be lit, and we envisioned these like lanterns. And so we looked at a perforated screen for when this was closed. It didn't seem closed. It had a function and a place within the plaza. So looking at citywide precedents, obviously looking at a lot of the things that were on the streets already. What were the lessons learned? Stainless works. Glass can work. In terms of perforations, this is sort of a precedent, but we didn't want to align ourselves too closely with that per se. But sort of looking at the vocabulary that has been established by the DOT and the language as a sort of a jumping off point for the design. Again, talking about lighting and this thing having a presence at night or when it's not occupied, looking at it as a beacon, and so allowing light to filter through the perforations so that it created an amenity or some sort of beacon within a closed nighttime plaza space. So just going to run through some of the various details here. So the exterior features, as I discussed, the folding security shutters, which can double as an awning. The structure being aligned here on all four sides means that the windows, the service windows, can be open entirely on all four sides as needed, or they can be closed for, depending on the sort of the nature of the concession and the preferred approach for bending. We looked at options where we maybe curve the exterior corners. We are aware of people moving past these things, but this starts to encroach on the already tight interior space and the usability of that space. We're looking at a modular approach to both the glass and to the bottom panels, because those are the ones that are going to come in most contact with people. So we wanted to, we're at the top, we have a single panel, and we'll talk about why we have that. Here, a modular system, same size as on all four sides, and it can be replaced if they get dented or damaged. Design flexibility. So again, this notion of these shutters is that they're spring-loaded, and so they want to be in the up position, and so you have to actually pull them down and lock them in place. Therefore, they cannot just fall on somebody while you're having a coffee or something like that. Also, depending on the nature and the situation and the type of concession, that these shutters can be closed on one or more sides potentially for like back of house reasons. If you have prep area back here, you might not want that extremely visible, but you still want light to be able to come through. Upper cladding stainless, we brought some samples here to discuss. We're looking at a non-directional stainless finish, sort of an angel hair finish, if you will. Perforated steel shutters, lower cladding, also with the angel hair finish, and we're talking about, we brought some samples where we want to discuss texture. I think we're still evaluating whether this is wants to be textured or not. I think we see real benefits in terms of disguising vandalism, discouraging scratching, people placing stickers on this, a perforated, or I mean a textured panel will make the removal of that much easier. However, potentially removing paint or ink or something like that may not be as easy. So we're still evaluating that. But I think from a basis we want, we're looking at a non-directional finish that's going to be sort of a deviation from the sort of universal directional number four finish, which is where you see on sort of everything, all the appliances, your refrigerator, stuff like that. We want to kind of get away from the sort of, let's say, agricultural and sort of home sort of goods finish. There's a shelving, ADA compliant, will lower the surface area as needed, and also a ramp for anybody who has accessibility issues getting in to the kiosk. Both things will be taken down and put inside of the kiosk at the end of the night. Again, to lock these shutters, you will need to remove these things. So everything goes inboard and gets stored inside of the kiosk at night, so there's nothing outboard of the kiosk when it's not in operation. We discussed this already. I just mentioned that. So yeah, the shutters get locked and again can be open or shut depending on what the back of house location is and whether or not the situation in a plaza warrants having all sides open. From the interior perspective, again, we've attempted to provide sort of a system of mounting angles and brackets with holes placed, 18 inches on the center or 16 inches on the center to allow for sort of a standard cabinetry fit out. Above, we're planning on having LEDs around the perimeter, which would be right above the prep and or transaction zone, and then the center zone sort of framing a mechanical opening here. The door does not have any lighting, but what we have on either side of the door that goes with the structure are the chases. So coming up, we want to have the power on one side. So you'd have your panel board and your light switches and whatever on one side. And on the other side, you'd have your drainage from the roof. So you have a single slope roof going back to a drain that's on the other side of the roof and discharges out. And you can remove the panels on the inside for the electrical routing and on the outside get to a drain clean out, for example. As David mentioned, we were trying to work with existing fit-out options. So nothing that you're seeing here is custom, probably pretty apparent, but trying to anticipate the needs of the various uses. We recognize that food service is probably the most likely and also probably the most strenuous in terms of the requirements spatially and mechanically on the kiosk. So this is what we looked at primarily to see that what we're proposing works and was the basis of design. We did some studies and some interviews with some current kiosk owners to find out what their uses were. So again, operation scenarios. Roof pitch, a single slope to the gutter, which is here. You have a mechanical chase, electrical and water chase potentially here. Secondary electrical chase on the outside of the drain, if possible. We're trying to really partition water and electrical, obviously, for good reason. And then we can access the both from the outside panels as needed. Again, non-food use scenario, not a very heavy lift here. Looking at storage above, sort of like what you might see in a boat, just stowage basically. Your counter area and then plenty of space below. We've looked at total volume of storage and the notion of the fit out here. This is looking at a symmetrical layout where the ADA space is right in the center be on a per concession basis. This is a more robust layout, looking at possible food vending scenario. Again, all of this stuff is, you know, equipment that we've gotten from some vendors saying this is the sort of stuff we like to use inside. Get a bit more, get a bit less space here, but sort of, you know, similar stowage, but you lose the storage up here because of the mechanical vent. And one thing we recognize is going to be sort of a hot button topic was how these things are branded, how these things are used, and how the people inside also get to display their wares, as it were, and the sort of connection between a vendor and customer. So the top panel again is a solid panel, and that's because we anticipate this being covered with a vinyl graphic, and this is what we're setting out as sort of the zone for that. And we felt that having it panelized with something you would read through the graphics and maybe would be not an appealing option. We're allocating space on either side of the transaction space for either graphics, menus, could be placement of goods there in those corners. And then we have sort of a belt, if you were, a little along here where you have additional branding. Sort of these ideas of what these will be are at this point unknown, but we felt like it was important to set a guideline overall, because we could envision a scenario where someone would want to cover the whole thing with vinyl graphics, and we felt that was not the right approach. So you know, this zone down here would be uncovered, and obviously most of most of the glazing area would be uncovered. So this is an example. The Asian Dog is not on board, as far as I know, as a potential vendor at this point, but this was sort of an application. If we took that scenario and played it out, this is what it might look like on this elevation. And then on the short side, you can see, you know, we have a similar set out, and everything is shrunk a bit more. That's it.
Great. Thoughtful as ever, Simon. Thank you. I have a question. If necessary, if it was a large public plaza, could two of these be ganged together?
Yes. Well, I think that we started with the envelope that we were given, but and it would have to be validated with the structural calculations. But the benefit of actually setting the structure inboard from the corners is that you're allowed to add, let's say, a bay. We think that adding a bay in either direction, widthwise and lengthwise, is definitely feasible given the structural size at this point. And the modulation of the panels would also work in that regard. That has not been our directive at this point, but we designed it thinking notionally that that could happen, and also talking to some of the vendors who said, you know, we have certain spaces, this is, you know, and they just arbitrarily picked their sizes of spaces, but we believe right now, based on the structural tube size, it's just basically it's 4x4 steel members. You have more than enough capacity to expand at least one bay in either direction, if needed, and if approved properly.
Right. Okay, that's good.
So I think it's a super clear presentation, you know, very nicely done. I have a question about the daylighting and whether you considered having solar tubes or photovoltaics or anything like that to, you know, enhance it from that point of view. And I think you could just get daylight. And I was looking at your design logic diagram and roofing plan. You know, you have space on either side where you could have solar tubes. I don't know if you consider that or it's some. I didn't see a section actually, so I don't know the section of the roof is, but you could just plot one in there.
Yeah, I mean, the roof is pretty standard. I mean, it's not, you know, there's nothing that would preclude that. I think it's definitely an option. You know, I think that we were looking at it as saying, we're going to open this thing up on all four sides, and just basically having glazed. east, and by having a perforated mesh if a vendor chose to close down one side. And we felt having four sides open of a fairly small volume was probably, you know, you're probably going to have plenty of daylight coming in, even on a day like today. But we haven't looked at the calculations of like foot candles or anything on the work surface or anything like that as of yet.
I guess it would depend on the openness of the mesh also, what you're, like you're going to get through that house.
Yeah.
Because how the light comes in and the angle into that workspace, the natural light as opposed to the LED.
Yeah.
It's just a thought.
No, it's, I mean, I think that we're always looking, I mean, that was part of what, you know, one thing of trying to open it up was also, you know, from a passive ventilation strategy, right, not having to have a lot of extra mechanical services in there, which would take up space and take more load, electrical load. So being able to open up all four sides too in the summer, even if one of the grids was closed, was something was appealing to us to try and get that sort of airflow as much as possible.
So the windows are operable?
Yes, all the windows on all four sides are operable.
I have a question about the branding and graphics approach. I know this is development, but and then you showed the NYC and DOT logos. It seems like almost some kind of like optional placement. I wonder if those should actually just be part of the structure itself, since it's, you know, it's a city and that needs to be provided. Rather than here, it looks like it might be optional.
Yeah.
So that's just a thought. And then the other thought was, you know, the branding across the top of the band. You know, I wonder if it's possible to create a more like encasement situation so that, you know, the branding across the top.
You mean like it's framed?
So that, you know, maybe it's like instead of, you know, the vinyl going directly on the surface of the kiosk, you know, seeing the prominent transparent plexiglass that's, you know, inserted into the top, something like that. So it's just so that it's, you know, more controlled, I think.
Okay.
I think that is a potential, you know, hot button issue where, you know, people won't follow standards.
Yeah. I would agree. That's why this is, I mean, we're trying to set out a standard. My only concern is with something like that is, so we've sort of tried to give margins, right? Like this is, and it also comes down to enforcement. I mean, honestly, it's sort of, you know, we can set guidelines, and if they're enforced properly, you know, I think it will look good. If it's, they're not enforced, then all bets are off in a way. I can't speak to that. But right now we're working on a project with MTA where there's a lot of backlit signage, let's say, and it operates in a certain way. The issue with that is like a water and dirt ingress sort of problem, and then you sort of have this sort of space behind, which can be problematic, especially in a steel structure, in terms of how do you inspect it, how do you clean it, how does it, you know, so I get totally hear what you're saying. My concern is to, I think we can look at something like that. My concern is that we don't sort of solve one problem and create another effectively, you know. We want to try and keep this as sort of simple as possible for, I think for the sort of the DOT, because they're on the hook to maintain, whereas the, you know, the vendor may come and go. But are you suggesting it's backlit, or are you suggesting it's just controlled?
I think your response is convincing.
Okay.
But I think some measure where it's more control, whether it's maintenance or enforcement or something in the structure.
Got it.
Of the kiosk. But I think I'm sure the effort. So that, I think what you said is
okay. All right. I just wanted.
I mean, the MTA does this interesting like metal frame that you can like open up and put something in and you close it back, so there's kind of flat. So I mean,
yeah.
I don't know. If there's something that's similar, like maybe a thicker plexiglass that could be. Screen and then the frame
could
be closed. I don't know.
No, I hear you. I think there's, like I said, there's always an issue with a mechanism,
right?
Where then you have a hinge somewhere, a big piano hinge. I mean, this thing is 10, you know, that panel will be 10 feet wide. Do you want a seam in the middle? Again, like I sort of take where you're, I mean, I get it. It just, you know, also when it comes to the practicality of making it and making it so, I mean, you guys have seen a lot of things that have big piano hinges and they get to bed and someone pulls on it, then the door won't close. Maybe you have it in a metal cabinet in your house. I mean, I've done that, right? So you've got a bent piano hinge, which are, that's why we even don't even like piano hinges, I hate piano hinges. Like, it's like, for certain things are bad. Piano hinges and VHB tape, or something. It's like, we'll never use it. Like, we'll never do it.
Okay.
Okay. Right. Okay. I'm sorry. Let me, this is my therapy session.
Okay. So, one little question that maybe leads, but I was looking at your roof drain.
Yes.
So, who's responsible? Because it's contained, right? You have a lip around the top and then one drain in the corner.
In the, on one side,
on the
yeah.
side, off yeah. the, yeah. So, these below, I mean, who's, I mean, DOT's going up there and clearing that one drain, because it's not open on that edge.
No, like a scupper.
It's a scupper, and then it's just clogged, and then somebody has to go up there, right?
Yes.
So the nuts and bolts of that would be included within our maintenance agreement, the concession agreement with our partners. So ultimately our partners would take responsibility for that day-to-day or seasonal type of maintenance. But they in turn could then pass that responsibility over to the actual operator themselves. But it would be all included and referenced in that.
Yeah, because it would be stuff.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's in a part, right? So I mean, it's certain things that we're not dealing with on other locations of these types of things. The benefit is that it's 10 feet tall, so I mean, you can get on a ladder. You know, it's not getting up on a, you know, a two-story roof or something like that. So I take your point.
So David, question for you. With the exception of Fordham, that has its own kind of custom. Let me just be very specific. Case in point. Bogardus in a landmark district. Mm-hmm. The idea is that this will be used as have the new stands and such in landmark or non-landmark districts.
That's correct.
Right. And so you're willing to fight for that, right?
Yes. Yeah. That's the intention.
Okay. I really feel this is a hugely important program. We have most of these plazas have got all the utilities in a specific location, waiting for this grand moment when, or we have some plazas that have, you know, their own designs. And so I feel it's really essential. I think it's part of the branding, and I believe it should be branded the public space, just like the newsstands have and the shelters, and having some ability to customize it with the signage, and having it, you know, a good almost a third of the face of the. That gives it the, you know, characteristic or branding. But it's a hugely important program, and I just would like to hear if you can identify any sites where this might not work, and what would be the alternative. Which is why I asked about the expandability of these.
Well, so is there a follow-up?
Just a follow-up, as I was thinking to what Sydney was saying, seeing the prototype, I just wondered, would this size and dimensions and so on necessarily work in every potential public plaza where food could be beneficial? Would it then occupy, in quotes, too much space and yet be an amenity for the public plaza, or is there a way to adapt it? That was just, I understand the prototype and I think it's terrific, but can that, or should it be modified to have the service in another kind of public plaza if needed?
You mean you're saying smaller?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I think it's functional way, it's designed to functionality, yeah, it could be small. My concern is making it bigger.
Oh, okay.
Because there are ones that are there today in different larger plazas that are much bigger.
Okay.
And so, for example, that's my.
Mm-hmm. So, fortunately, the universe citywide is fairly small. You know, there's 73 plazas citywide currently. Whilst all of our partners will be offered the opportunity to enter into a sub-concession agreement. We don't expect that all of those would want to engage in that for various reasons. So the actual number of sites citywide is somewhat is manageable from that perspective, from a kind of inventory management perspective. But secondly, kind of then on the ground itself, the spaces, Plaza's program spaces tend to be really quite small, and competition for space is very high. We're specifically purposefully targeting neighborhoods in the city that lack open space. And so we want to be able to ensure that there's flexibility within the design. We want to make sure that there's sufficient room for pedestrian circulation, and then for programming as well. So that those are really our priorities from a program perspective. And so we want to make sure that we're not taking anything away from those core functions when we're thinking about opportunities for sub-concessions. So demand for space is very high, which is what led us to this relatively small footprint. I think to your point, considering the flexibility and the need for the need to be able to accommodate a lot, I think we've landed on this footprint as kind of the minimum. I think the number of spaces which are large enough to accommodate a larger structure is actually very, very small. But in those instances, as Simon explained, we could potentially consider the possibility of expanding the footprint of those. Again, that would all be, say, at Flatiron, for example, which was in the cover photograph, or a photograph in very early on in the presentation. That's a very large space, which is just about to go into its capital design. We're just starting the preliminary design for that now. At that part of this early stage of the process, through coordination with our partners, we'll be talking about their needs, we'll be talking to their sub-concessionaires to understand exactly what they need from a space perspective. I think we'll let those conversations dictate kind of what their optimum footprint needs to be, and then we can have a detailed a conversation with them about, is adapting this design the appropriate way to go at that location? Then I think we also want to acknowledge that our partners would have the freedom to develop their own design on their own, on their own steam, with their own funds, to create a much more contextual solution to the problem as well, which would be subject to its own review process by the Public Design Commission. But we want to make sure that we allow for that desire, should there be one, in addition to potentially offering an expanded footprint of this particular version as well.
So you're saying you're not going to require this? Because here's the question. Why have we not seen what's out there at Flatiron? They've been there more than a year.
They don't operate year-round. The structures are actually closed, and in some instances they are moved or taken away. So they do operate for less than a year.
But they occupy the physical presence of the plaza for more than a year.
No, they are moved. They are moved. They are removable structures. They don't have any foundation or anything like that. But it is a shortfall. This is why we really want to be able to develop this design and create this permanent option, because our partners and we need to have that year-round presence. It's really vital. For the reasons I explained, it's vital from a programmatic perspective, but then also from a revenue generation perspective as well.
So will in those locations, those be removed, like the one you showed in your presentation, and then this would be replaced?
Right, that's the intention. So our partners will have the option of, like I said, of entering into the process of establishing a permanent kiosk, and then the temporary structures will be removed and will be replaced with the.
Have you any idea, when you set that $50,000 price point, who pays for these, the partners or the concessionaire?
So the intention moving forward is that for all projects beyond this point, once we have your approval, the city will cover that cost as part of the capital reconstruction. So we'll pay for it, we'll include that within the estimates and program that we develop at DDC. And then we'll deliver the shell, much in the same way that we have done before.
So that's a really good incentive. Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to avoid the scenario of what happened many years ago. I don't think anyone here was on the commission, of Flatiron coming with two of the most let me just say, unfortunate designs next to the Flatiron building. I mean, it was appalling, and we just flat out rejected it. And you know, it would be much easier for a concessionaire to you know, drink the Kool-Aid here than have to come back to us and get rejected.
Right.
I mean, it was so awful. I don't even know how they could even imagine that this would fly. I mean, they look like surf shacks next to the fire. Anyway, I really, really, I'd love to make this decision once.
We have that little bit of that issue about the newsstands, right? We have a newsstand and a set of criteria that are automatically approvable on the consent agenda, and then they come here and we reject them when they do the right? So I think the lesson is easy to learn if people are, and I think I think Zinni's right. I think the advantage for many, many plazas and concessionaires and partners to have a free kiosk versus the time and expense of designing a kiosk, presenting a kiosk, getting rejected by us, or giving a hard time by us, and then building a kiosk is huge. I mean, night and day. And I think it's great to have these concessions available to a broader group of entrepreneurs because you've made the capital commitment on them than would be necessary for someone. I mean, I think that's a very equitable solution, to use the mayor's word, going forward. For these concessions, so I applaud that. $50,000, I don't believe you can get it done for that, but what even close to that is hugely different than what would otherwise be necessary. So I think it's great.
It's great, great, great program. It's a really nice design, too. And I was thinking of the ones that are outside by Brooklyn Bridge, the ones outside of the building, those apartments.
Yeah.
They're just so overly designed and heavy, you don't even know what's inside.
Right.
So these are super light and efficient, and I
really think. Well, are there different standards for the non-permanent ones? Because I know there's like the Astro Place, as you mentioned, they're like pink, and they're like totally, and they're not there all the time, but when they are there, they're really sore. It's very distracting. It takes away from the positive structure on Astro Place. So I don't know. Is there a standard?
Well, I thought that was important. That is in our notes here, I think it says temporary kiosks such as those at Astor Place will not be replaced with a permanent prototype. DOT is working on a separate update.
Well, that's specific to Astor Place because it is a conversation that we've had with some of you in the past. And so we included a list of. In our submission materials, we included a list of all of the previously approved kiosk locations, which would then, once this was approved and moving forward, they would then fall into that track. But because we've had a specific conversation about Astor Place, we want to come back and continue that very location-specific conversation.
But you should do that.
Yeah.
You should come back and continue that conversation.
Yes, very much so.
It's gotten worse.
Oh, yes.
Not that it was good before. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Unanimous, and the public meeting is now adjourned.